Reforming business.
Hope not.
Take two.
Good morning, Herschel.
Good morning, Miss Butterfly.
It is a special assembly this today because tomorrow is the start of Arbor Week. And we're starting first of all with a musical item, which is Somewhere Out There. Thank you.
Lovely way to start assembly. We now move on to our hymn this morning, which is We Shall Go Out With Joy. So girls, I'm going to ask you to stand during it, and let's be a bit creative with some actions, whatever you feel works. Please stand.
Most importantly mentioned item or living creature in the Bible, besides God, besides people, are trees. And don't you think trees are really important? Because you're also in good company. God loves trees too. In scripture, trees are often shown as things that communicate. One of the references is in Isaiah chapter 55, verse 12. The trees clap their hands. We've just listened to that. And in Chronicles 16, verse 33, the trees shout for joy. Again, we've just listened to that. And in Judges, one of the books in the Bible, trees even argue. And for years, when people read the Bible, they thought that was just poetry. But in the last 20 years, tree scientists have discovered that trees really do communicate with each other. In fact, their communication has been dubbed or like named as the Wood Wide Web. Not the World Wide Web, which we refer to, but the Wood Wide Web. All right, and there's lots of information about that. I'm not going to tell you too much about that, but what I am going to talk to you about this morning is one of my favorite stories in the Bible, which refers to a tree. And many of you may be familiar with it. It's about the story of Zacchaeus. So Zacchaeus was really rather a horrible man. I'll tell you straight, Bill, he was not very nice. He was unpopular because, and I'm sure you will have heard your parents discuss this matter, he was a tax collector. And nobody likes paying tax. But in those days, the taxes were collected not for their own governors, but for the invading country, which was the Romans. And the Romans were not popular. And Zacchaeus wasn't paid a salary. The way he earned money was, if Lily owed $100 in taxes, he would charge $120. So he would give the $100 to the Romans, and he kept 20 for himself. Now imagine if I just did that to all of you, I would quickly be a very wealthy lady. All right, and that's exactly what Zacchaeus did, and he was fabulously wealthy. He was also short. Now, Mrs. Hyde and I are both tall, and we can tell you lots of stories about short men, but we won't go there today. All right, so he was walking in the street, and he had heard about Jesus. He was walking in the street when he saw a large crowd. This was in the city of Jericho, and he asked someone what was going on. And that crowd, one of the men said to him, Jesus has come to town, Jesus has come to town, Jesus has come to town. But now he was short, and he was in the crowd, and he couldn't see, and he couldn't see, and he couldn't see. So his plan was then to run ahead of the crowd, and he climbed up into the sycamore tree. Now, if you look at the sycamore tree, we can see it's got some fantastic branches. So he stood in one of the, he climbed up in one of those branches. Girls, he could now see Jesus coming towards him. And the moment Jesus arrived at the tree, and Jesus and Zacchaeus looked at each other, Zacchaeus realized that he had been horrible to the people around him. And he knew that he had to change his heart. And you know what Jesus did? He said to him, as soon as he saw him, Zacchaeus, come down from that tree, because I am going to have supper at your house tonight. The people in the crowd were horrified. How could Jesus go with this horrible man? But immediately, Zacchaeus said, I am sorry. Half of what I earn, I will now give to the poor. And anybody who I have cheated, I will pay back 4 times the amount. That's how his heart changed when he saw Jesus. And the story of Zacchaeus tells us one very important thing. That if we really look for Jesus and want to find him, he will always find us. So let's just bow our heads and pray, folks. God, thank you for this day. Thank you for the birds and the animals, the flowers and the trees, the lakes and the streams, and the sun that rises and sets over them each day. Thank you for creating everything we see. Thank you for the life we live and for making each person different. Thank you for giving us Jesus. What an amazing God you are. Amen. What did we say, Our Father? Is that the ring song?
Amen. my King of Peace. For Jesus Christ's sake. Amen.
And the grace?
May the goodness of God, the love of God, and the power of God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be with us today. Amen.
Also, I'm going to hand over to Mrs. Morris.
Thank you very much. I'm going first. Oh, thank you, please. Good morning, girls. It's so exciting. So many new happenings in the school at the moment. We have Spring Day tomorrow, Arbor Day tomorrow, and today is the official launch of the Grow Green Library Week. Okay, now we're going to do things a little bit upside down this year. We're starting with quite a clean slate in the library, and I'm going to ask you to come and help decorate the library as the week progresses. So our theme is growing green. So it's like we're planting the little seed today, and then I want to see how you can transform a library for us. But it's more than just about the decoration. I quickly want to share a few thoughts with you about seeds and how they grow. And to do that, I thought I would just quickly plant one. Okay, so I've got to put on my gumboots. Okay, if I work in the garden, I put on my gumboots. And I take off my fancy top. Just one though, there we go. And then I'm going to move the table over here. Will you help me, Mrs. Parker? And then I also have a few gardeners here to help me today. Those are my library monitors. So if they would come and maybe just sit here on a little step for when I need you, thank you, ladies. And in a minute, I have another little surprise for you, but let's just get this growing thing started. Because I watched a little video last night, and it was this video about, a little clip about where somebody put a seed in the soil, and then it goes, so I thought, well, if that can happen, we'll make it happen in a seed. Okay? If that's how fast a seed can grow, I need it to grow that fast. So they're going to help me. I'm just fetching my stuff. Okay. All right. We've got all kinds of things to assist.
Can you just check?
No. This is my call. So is it all right if I'm here? Okay. Hold the water. Those gumboots. Gumboots. Okay, so watching the video last night, I thought I'm going to need a few things. Who can help me quickly? What's the first thing I would need if I wanted to plant a seed? Yes.
Soil.
And I nearly forgot that. So I quickly had to go dig under the tree there. So I'm not a professional gardener. So here I've got the soil. Then I've got container. Then I've got nice yucky stuff. Why do I have nice yucky stuff in here? Yes.
Does it make good compost?
It makes good compost. Girls, in whatever I'm telling you in the next 5 minutes, we're going to have a bit of a quiz in the library and there'll be spot prizes, eh? So remember the word organic. And compost, just a little tip. All right, so we've got the soil. All right, I need one of you, Miss Sinners, will you come? And you can just do, could you just put all the soil in there? Okay, now I've been trying to think, what would this poor little seed need? Tell me other things seeds need to grow. Yes?
Oxygen.
I can do it. What else?
Water.
Whoops. Water. Yes, of course. Here's some water. We'll put it in there and we'll pour in a minute. What else do we need? I think this message is going south a little bit. What else would the seed need?
Sunlight.
Sunlight. You're quite right.
So we'll angle the pot a little bit so that it's in there. And then what do I need to do with the seed? Who wants to plant? Come, little gardener, all kitted out. There we go. I think you just didn't want to be recognized. There we go. Plant the seed, my darling. Thank you. Now, if Miss Lyon Bruno, could you come and give it a squirt of weed killer? We don't want any weeds. There we go.
It's organic.
Of course it is. I brewed it last night. Some seed grow, you know, we'll just do that. It doesn't smell very nice. Then some slugum. We don't want weeds. Sure, but yes, let's see, what else? I did bring
a little
shovel, but maybe not right this moment. Girls, what else do I have to plant? Okay, then perhaps one of the ladies could just come and hold the umbrella. Because storms do come, don't they? There we go. You protect our little plant. And now if you could just all come and make a circle around this plant, and we are going to tell it to grow. So the louder we can yell. Okay, can we have words of encouragement?
Grow.
Grow.
You can do it.
Grow. You can do it. You did not yell loud enough, but for the moment you can sit down. Thank you. Now you must still protect
it. Dad team, if I'm trying to do something, I just
want to
say they're good.
Yeah, they really are motivational. And now I brought another little seed, but that seed wouldn't fit into the tin. So could Chief just bring me the other stuff I need for my plant? There's these ladies, girls, look at me. Could you move your chairs back to one? There we go. I need more stuff to plant. Hey. It's for the hair. Alright, thank you, Mr. G. You just put it right there. This is, thank you, sir. Thank you, Mr. G. All right, so girls, I think I wonder if I should sit down for, no, maybe not. You know all that I'm going to tell you about each of us being a little, some of us bigger than others. We all keep growing, we never stop growing. We need certain things. All those things you mentioned. If you're a little seed, we've got it here. It's a nursery. It's the loveliest place for girls to grow. I'm sure you'd agree, but I want to show you my surprise seed, and then I actually want you today to think about the power that a gardener has. The power that a gardener has. Where is that fatty thing? Thank you. A gardener does a lot of things to help the plant grow. But if you cut too much, you aren't getting time.
Fine.
Gardeners support. Support. You can put your arm down, my darling. When little plants need support to grow to the sun, the gardeners provide that. The good soil, the compost. And we all actually little gardeners. We have our own little gardens in our hearts and in our minds. We garden other people's gardens. We want them to flourish. But now I'm just quickly going to plant this little. This want to wake up, she wants to go back to sleep. No gardener could fix that. So you go back to sleep. Watch them, girls. We have the best gardeners in the school. We have the best little seeds. Just realize it's not only the teachers that are the gardeners. Not only the teachers that are supporting and encouraging and helping you weed. You are working in your own garden. And sometimes you need to ask for a bit of support. Or you need to ask for a bit of compost. Doesn't sound right. You need to ask so that you can flourish. Because we're actually a bit like stodels, this place. We actually just want everybody to flourish. Even lazy little seeds like this. I think I'm now going to tip the wheelbarrow and tip her out. Either that or you scoot quickly. Can we give her a hand? She did it.
Girls, let's grow together in the week that's coming. Grow green. Get involved. Collect your cans. There will be daily challenges. Daily challenges posted in the library. Competitions. Lucky draws. And a lot of decorating to be done. Grow green. Remember the cans. And the hacking that's happening on Saturday. Do you know about that? Where families go and they join Mrs. Raymond and they're going to go and hack up alien plants. Am I right, Mrs. Raymond? Parents were sent a little link. They just have to click on it, enter the details, and I want photos of you hacking away because we grow green.
Girls, this morning we are incredibly privileged to have Misha Teasdale come and speak to us. He's going to be alive, he's waiting for us to come and talk. And Misha is the co-founder of Green Pop, and he is a Cape Town legend. He loves planting trees and is a big believer in the environmental space and how spending time in nature makes us all better, kinder, more whole people. His mission in life is to get active for the environment, not anxious, to do something. So we're so privileged to have him here this morning to speak to us. Welcome, Misha.
Thank you.
Would you like
to turn your camera on, please? Thank you.
Hi. Do I get to see the audience? Or,
yes, let me show you.
Sir. There you go. Wonderful. Hello.
Hello.
Hi there, girls. So fantastic to be here. Can you leave it on there just so that I'm if that's possible? Oh, thank you. So I'm Misha Teasdale. I'm one of the founders of Green Pop. We're based in Cape Town, but we've got projects that we do in Zambia and Tanzania and Malawi. Maybe just to start, just to kind of shake off last night's sleep and get us into the mode of listening and learning, perhaps all of you can just put your hands by your sides and like shake out your fingers a little bit, and then take a big meaningful breath in and raise up your arms, and then breathe out like lionesses. Okay, that's the first time I've done that digitally. I hope it went okay.
Fantastic.
So that's oxygen free and abundant. Thank you to the trees. I've been planting trees now for 11 years, and my journey really started a long time before that. One of the biggest lessons that I got was initiated when I was 23 years old. I was fortunate enough to drive from Cape Town to London across the continent of Africa. And as you can imagine, it's a big undertaking to do something of that extent. And I felt incredibly privileged to have been able to do it, to go and visit 21 African countries, to have driven 13,000 kilometers to witness the places in Gorogoro Crater, the Okavango Delta, sailing down the Nile. And I got three specific lessons that came out of that experience. The first one was that constantly I was having to connect to people that didn't speak my language or I didn't speak their language. And in the beginning, that can be uncomfortable, but as you start to navigate the process and find ways to connect, it's incredible how it can open up your compassion. One of the experiences I had was our vehicle broke down in Ethiopian highlands, and the lead vehicle had to go back a week to Bahia Dar to go and get the parts we needed. And we were stranded, and I landed up making friends with a priest. He had a little cathedral, which was about 3 meters in diameter. It had this beautiful little window at the top of the cathedral, a couple of meters up, with sharp light that came through. And we sat together, we drank honey mead, and we ate food together, and we had a beautiful experience, but we didn't speak each other's language. And I recall at the end of each day when we went up there, we were always laughing and cheering and having just this incredible connect. So one of the lessons was compassion for me. Another experience was when you drive across an entire continent, and the backstory to that is when you plan for an entire year to drive across an entire continent and you get to the other side of it, the initial part of the journey, it just seemed completely unfathomable. My experience was that if I have a sufficient amount of horsepower and passion, if I apply a plan, then I can really accomplish anything. You see, before, I hadn't really done much with my life. I'd studied, I'd gone to university. I was pretty much a regular Joe. But having done that experience, having driven across an entire continent, it really gave me the sense of mind that if I put my mind to something, I can really accomplish anything. And then the last thing that I got out of it was I studied industrial design, and I was a big believer in problem solving. And having driven from one country to the next, I was constantly experiencing these massive social and environmental challenges. And that got me down. Everywhere I went, I'd see forests being cut down, and huge amounts of litter in cities like Dar es Salaam and Addis Ababa. And it made me feel quite heavy. I felt like I was carrying around a big rock. But I was also feeling individuals and groups coming together and making amazing things happening. And I started then shift my perspective. One that was before looking at the problem and then looking at it in a different way, which was around opportunities. And you see, what we started eventually was a social enterprise. It's taking a problem. The problem was insufficient green spaces, The problem was deforestation, and seeing it as an opportunity to reconnect people, to bring people together. And so that shift of mindset was such an aspect for me. I fast forward 2 years later, I become a documentary filmmaker, I filmed experience through Africa, I produced a short video out of it, and I got picked up by a few different documentary organizations. And I landed up doing a trip where I flew around the world, made a documentary for Volkswagen. And at the back end of that, I landed up flying 360,000 kilometers. And I wanted to do something about it. So I decided to plant 1,000 trees in the undergreen school of the West Cape. Now we have 26,000 schools in South Africa, something like that. And many of them look nothing like Herschel. They have lots of barbed wire, burglar bars, there are no trees. There's very few places that one could look at and say, wow, I'm really proud of this space. So having got back to South Africa and feeling like I wanted to do something about my environmental footprint, I decided I was going to plant 1,000 trees in the undergrowth schools of the West Cape. We started a whole bunch of campaigns to raise money for trees, to get volunteers to come and help us plant those trees. We essentially created a huge amount of momentum out of it. One of the campaigns we did is we got a whole bunch of superhero cloaks made up, green superhero cloaks with a Jeep or green top on the back. And we got friends on bicycles and skateboards and rollerblades to go through rush hour traffic on Duval Drive, where the traffic was bumper to bumper. We burned up the radio station and said, see our superheroes in the traffic, honk your horn. And then we got onto Twitter and essentially started tweeting up a storm about it. And Duval Drive came alive at the sound of honking horns. People loved the idea. And all of a sudden, we trended in Cape Town for the first time, and people started to sign up to be volunteers. Another thing we did is we went to markets and schools and events, and we sold little pieces of cardboard that had a stamp on it that said, join the tree village. And on the back, there was a number, and the number represented a tree. And literally, people loved the idea. All they were getting was this little cardboard. I think that they believed so much in what we believed in because we had such conviction of what we wanted to do with it. And literally in one day, we sold 70 different pieces of cardboard. It's such an incredible experience when someone believes in your story, when you are willing to go out there and engage with public and believe so strongly in something that you're going to do that people want to believe in this positive action that's going to happen. Anyway, on the 1st of September, which is tomorrow, 11 years ago, we planted our first tree. We planted 5 trees in about 4.5 hours. I had never planted a tree before. I had owned no spades. I didn't have a bucky. And we just learned by doing. And every other day for that month, we went out and we planted trees. Connected fellow South Africans. We created a huge amount of groundswell and momentum, and it just was quite an incredible experience. And on the last day, we planted 1,000th tree with Woolworths. It was 300 trees that day, with 250 staff from Woolworths that came out. And what was incredible about it is at the end of the day, one of the managers from Woolworths came, he shook my hand, he said, Richard, today I had one of my most significant South African moments. Because I really got to connect with South Africans in a neutral way, in a happy way, in a way that was meaningful. And that really touched me. And it was one of the catalysts that made me think, let's continue with this. Let's carry on planting trees. And then a whole bunch of other things started happening. We had companies contacting us saying, we would like to plant trees on an ongoing basis. We had lots of individuals wanting to come and join the movement. And we had a lot of beneficiaries contacting us saying, we really would like to green our spaces. And we live in such a divided country. And there is something so significant about the opportunity to bring people together in the mutual act, in the legacy act, of putting trees into the ground. So that was 11 years ago. We've now planted 150,000 trees, a little bit more than that. And for me, what's more important in those trees is the hands that plant them. It's the individuals like yourselves that simply decided to get active and not anxious about the state of the world that we live in. And there's a lot happening in the world right now. And yeah, I suppose one way to get through the anxiety, one way to get through particularly all the emotional and mental illnesses that can come out of the idea of climate change, which is so far removed from us, is removing ourselves from the apathy, putting ourselves into a place of saying, I'm going to be proactive in this space. I believe that everyone that's sitting in the room right now has a role to play. There is an absolutely incredible amount of work that needs to be done. This year, the United Nations launched the UN Decade on Restoration, essentially 10 years where they campaign with businesses, organizations, individuals like yourselves to put a rallying call behind restoring landscapes. Landscapes are literally the foundation to achieving the Sustainable Development Goals. Without healthy landscapes, we cannot have healthy food, we cannot have gender equality, we cannot have educated individuals if we are living in degraded landscapes. It's very difficult to achieve those. So it is both figuratively and literally the foundation to achieving all the Sustainable Development Goals. So what do we do now? Well, we have a program called Forests for Life that is community-centric tree planting, plant trees around sub-Saharan Africa. We have an urban greening program which operates here in the Western Cape, planting sustainable fossil bathrooms. We have an environmental awareness project which has worked with WWF and British Council and hosts of other institutional NGOs to bring environmental awareness to people across the world. And we also have a food program where we supply family food boxes to low-income communities through individual fundraising. Those ultimately allow for us to host a year-long workshop on producing healthy, nutrient-dense food. So how do you fit in? Well, if you want to join GreenPop, you are welcome to sign up to run for trees, to dance for trees, to cycle for trees. We even have people hike the Himalayas for trees. You can check out our website, which is greenpop.org, or our Instagram, which is just greenpop, and follow us and find out more about some of the cool things we're up to and get active with us in our tree planting efforts or in our fundraising efforts. I'm lucky enough to actually be heading off to the Garden Roots in 2 weeks' time to go plant 2,000 trees in some of the fire-affected areas from the fires that happened there in 2017 and 2018. Very excited to be there. I'm going to be actually joined by a lot of young people from the school from around the Cape and South Africa. Before I go, I'd like to just show you a brief video of one of the projects that we've got in the Overberg region. It's the southernmost forest in Africa. It's very dear to my heart. I'll show this video and then I'll hand over back over to Margot. Thank you so much for listening to me this morning. And I hope you've been sufficiently inspired to go out there and do something for your environment. And hopefully come and connect with us in the near future. I still have time to show a video, or am I running too late?
No, we do have time, but I just want to say something to you quickly.
Okay.
Thank you so much for spending your time and sharing your inspiring message with us.
Thank you, everyone. I really appreciate it. And thank you for the donation. When I started this journey, I never planted a tree before. Here we are, 10 years later, and we've planted 140,000 trees. Every single time those trees is planted, it's another legacy, it's another intention of reconnecting with nature.
I've been coming year after year, and every year is a different experience. It gives me different things to think about and take home with me.
I think it's easy to be forgotten how prevalent nature is in and around us, especially people that live in cities. It's like you see trees every now and then, but being in a space that's mostly trees or even planting it yourself, it's like this is the world that exists more than just Minecraft.
I think that tree planting is important because it really puts you in a space to get intimate with nature.
I think when we connect with nature, we can't help but connect with ourselves.
the way that we can engage in planet with ourselves, with our landscapes, it's really destructive. And it doesn't have to be.
It's incredibly pertinent to so many of our skills, whether they be ecological or social. The reforestation program supports a lot of jobs, so it becomes an industry of its own. And it's something that has given my life the most incredible meaning.
There's just this massive knock-on effect happening by actively engaging with financing restoration with a very open mind. We believe that there's just a whole spectrum of values that come out of this. What we need to do is get more people into the landscape. So hosting an event like this, where you can get 10 people, 100 people, 1,000 people together to actively start participating in the process, I believe it's a really powerful way to start shifting that mindset. I'm excited about this today. And I feel like there's this critical role that we all have in making this reality, saying, how am I going to jump in? What's my role? How am I going to make this happen?
Thank you so much. Thank you. So I think from my side, just to say to Mrs. Rayback and Mrs. Schroeder, thank you so much for everything you're doing with regard to sustainability. I know that it doesn't just happen, and I know that there's much time spent discussing and meeting and planning and thinking. And I think, girls, on our behalf, I think we should say thank you very much to Mrs. Rayback, because these are the things that we wouldn't know about unless somebody actively went to look. So when you heard Misha speaking about either being anxious and apathy, which means not doing anything, or being active, I think we see huge activity happening because of your actions from the two of you. So I just want to say thank you. We really appreciate it. Will you thank the two of them for the work they're doing to remind us about the time? I just want to say, I loved it. I laughed a lot, which is really a good sign on a Tuesday morning. But I don't think we're ever going to forget about this planting. So
I would love to get some water.
Yes, sir, please don't forget to water. I think one of you girls is going to have to take responsibility to remind Mrs. Moritz that we need to water that. But thank you. Thank you for the practical side of it. Thank you for the reminders about how we can flourish. And I think girls, the thing that stood out for me in that was while I was sitting there, you were mentioning the fact that we have the ability to allow something to flourish, or we have the ability to cut it down.
Yes, actually,
and we know, yes, exactly. And so girls, remember that this is almost like your words. You know, when we build them up or we cut somebody down, sometimes somebody is there to help you and they do the little pruning. Do you know what pruning means? When you prune something, a plant, and then it allows it to grow better. But the other side of it is when you hack it down, it's gone. So we don't want to hack people down. But we do want to prove where there's space to grow. And I think that's something to remember in the growing people. So before we finish assembly, I just want to do house points, if that's okay. You will have noticed that Mrs. Martin is not here. She has an ear infection, girls. And if you've ever had an ear infection, it's a bad ear infection. It affects your balance. So we did check in with her last night, and I'm sure she'll be back hopefully as soon as possible. But you can imagine she's pretty frustrated being at home and not being able to be here this morning. So house points for the week. Let's go ahead. So in fourth place at the moment, we have Carter with 260. So clap for the 260. And in third place, Jagger with 280. And then seconds and first. So in second place, Merriman with 320. And Ross Marlene with 380. Either Miss Costas or Ross, I'm not sure, that's why I'm just moving out the way.
So, maybe girls, can you, while they get ready, can you just quietly flip your chair so that you can face that way? So just to explain, I'm going to take my mark. So every year our grade sevens have the privilege in this term to put together house starts. And even though we've had restrictions and COVID and they have managed to safely and very amazingly put together these house dances. And what we're going to do this year, we've got four dances, and we're going to have maybe, we're thinking, and one of them will end up being our flash mob. But we're going to see how that will come about. But we're starting this week with Roll Stars. They came to bed together incredibly well and incredibly quickly, and they've done an amazing job. So this is Roll's house dance. Okay, don't worry. We're going to swap, but it'll be fine. So I'm going to hand over to them. And then just a reminder, girls, all the teamers for matches this week will be on the walls later. Yay! Yay! So over to Roll.
Exercise competition.
long ball drive school, what a learners can join you somewhere. What do you think? That would be fun. So then we can do that. So well done.
Well done. We look forward to the other houses in the coming weeks.
So thank you for starting the school.
Thank you so much.
So girls, as we finish this assembly, I want to challenge you with something. So I had a meeting with a parent, and they were saying to me, it's so interesting. When they go into a boys' school, every single boy that they see greets, they either good afternoon, good morning, good evening, and sometimes they add a bam or a sir or whatever it might be. So my question is, do you notice that with commercial girls? No. Oh my word. So my challenge to you is the following. Everybody that you see, please greet them. Good morning, good afternoon, or good evening. You don't need to know their name. When you greet them, I want to see some good eye contact. So please greet the people next to you quickly. Go for it. Show them how you do it. Excellent. Meet the person behind you and in front of you.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. Right. And girls, can I explain why it's important? So let me show you what this looks like. You show them that already. We're going to walk towards each other. Watch this. You just need to walk past me.
How do you feel it?
It's no. I'm sorry. Let's try that again. Okay. Walk past each other again. How do you feel there, Shona?
Not special.
Not special. Okay, let's try again. Round three. Morning.
Morning.
How do you feel?
Fantastic.
Okay. What are you going to try to do? How you being now?
Perfect.
Woohoo!
Okay,
so I'm going to do a little check-in and find out how it's going. When visitors come in, I'm going to ask them, will you greet them? I'm going to ask teachers. All teachers, will you greet them? I'm going to ask every staff member, will you greet them? At the end of the week, we're going to do a little audit. I'm also going to ask you as girls, did somebody greet you today who wasn't a friend? Because very often that matters more than anything else. So this is a place where we want to see each other. See each other, acknowledge each other, greet each other, because as soon as that happens, you feel like you belong. Sense of belonging is easy, girls, when you greet first. So that's my challenge. Have a fabulous week, everybody. I hope it's going to be fun. I look forward to those matches that are happening. Really going to be good. I'll be out there to see you. Have a good week, everyone. Thank you so much.